Hey everybody, welcome back to another Judgment Commentary of Koi Monogatari, but today, we're going to be checking out episode 4. But last time, on episode 3, Kaiki reported his findings to Senju Gahara, and he concluded that Nadako would actually be fairly easy to trick because, well, she's an immature airhead. And given that he does have a position of trust with her right now, he could dupe her relatively easily into thinking that Araragi and Senju Gahara were killed, thus keeping them safe. Although I will admit that I did have a misunderstanding in that scene, because later on I said that there might be a problem in that if he only says Senju Gahara and Araragi are dead, then she might get suspicious and because, well, he didn't say Shinobu was. But I forgot two things. One, he has met Shinobu back in Nisei, so he does know about her. I'm stupid. Two, Senju Gahara did tell him that he has to save Shinobu as well, so he would likely have to tell Nadako that Shinobu was killed, and he would likely intend to as well, but I just got thrown off because he didn't mention her when he talked about the plan. He only said Araragi and Senju Gahara, and it threw me off, but a lot of what also threw me off was based on my own misunderstandings. But still, he has a solid plan, a plan that could very well work given the right circumstances, and hey, the plan seems solid enough that even Senju Gahara was relieved to hear it. She even had to go off and cry for a little bit because she was so relieved that she and Araragi would be perfectly fine. And it was a very touching moment. But then a conflict arose in that Ononoki showed up and told Kaiki that he needed to abandon ship, that he needed to stop trying to trick Nadako, or else things might go horribly wrong. This was a message from Gaia and Izuko, who told him that even though he has a high chance of success, if on the off chance that he does fail, it could completely throw everything out of whack and just disrupt the perfect balance that she has set up. But Kaiki, being Kaiki, isn't going to back down. In fact, her telling him to back off just made him want to do it a whole lot more. So he was even willing to cast his relationship with Izuko aside, and he went back to talk to Nadako, and he did learn one thing that he didn't quite have a grasp on before, and it's that Nadako is absolutely bonkers. Before, he just thought that she was immature and naive, but after spending a little bit more time with her, he's realized that she's out of her mind, which might complicate things just a bit, but now that he knows it, I'm sure he can at least plan around. He's got plenty of time. By the way, another piece of information we got from Ononoki was that Gaia and Izuko initially intended to try to make Shinobu a god, but then Nadako becoming a god disrupted those plans, and at first, when I heard that she wanted her to be a god, I thought, would that not go horribly wrong? Because last time Shinobu was a god, the darkness came in and ate everybody. So would that not happen again? No, it wouldn't. Because unlike before, Shinobu would actually be a god. Because the difference is that in the past, Shinobu wasn't a god. People just thought she was. She had not actually become a god. If she had accepted being a god and, you know, transitioned into being one for real, then the darkness would not have shown up. So in this case, if she had transitioned into fully being a god and had discarded her vampirism, then there would have been no problem. And one last thing before we get started. One of you guys informed me that the koi in Koi Monogatari refers to a different character than the word koi for the fish. It refers to a symbol meaning love or affection, which would mean that this arc is called Love Story. How ironic that the arc centered around Kaiki is called Love Story. Perfect. So maybe the fact that there's a lot of fish imagery is just related to, you know, that koi is a homophone for the word that means like the fish, but maybe not, it could just be some other deeper meaning, or it might not mean anything at all, and I'm just reading too deep into it, which I didn't think was possible for this. But enough rambling, without further ado, let's head right back in for episode 4. Things of note. One, Hanakawa, she got to appear once again with her hair still in that fashion, which is interesting because she did say that eventually she dyes it to be all black again, but as of this point in time, it's still mixed in with the Marie Antoinette. And Hanakawa did a quick little lie of sorts. She said that she would be going overseas, which she did. However, she didn't stay, she came back briefly, and now she wants to exchange some information with Kaiki, which Senju Gahara is not aware of. She still thinks that she's overseas, and part of this was also to have a vain attempt at dancing around Gaien's watchful eye, but given that she knows everything, I mean, when you think about it, if she really does know everything, then she would know that Kaiki wouldn't listen to her. Right? She would know that he wouldn't, and she would know that he would just take the money and then still do it anyway. If he's aware that she knows everything, then he should have been taking that into account. That's not as important. What is important is that, well, Hanekawa seems to be not able to be read by Kaiki all too well. Kaiki doesn't seem to have a good read on her. I mean, he's trying to figure out what her intents are, but he's having difficulty. Which is why he's pretty much just given in and is willing to exchange information as of right now. Other than that, the big question mark is still the individual who left him that note telling him to stay out of it. I've been racking my brain trying to think if there's some third parties out there who would want him to stay out of it. They thought it might be Araragi briefly, but no, Araragi's not the kind of guy who would, you know, just leave a note like that. I can't think of too many who are stealthy note leavers. Most of them are kind of the people who would just go and talk to them point blank. It's peculiar. There are a few I can think of who would be mixed up in the supernatural balance of this town like this and would want him not to muck about with Nadako. I suppose we'll have to wait and see. Like, we're also gonna have to wait and see about the closet, because he opened it and he looked inside and saw something weird in there. At least it looked like he saw something weird, and we still don't know what it was. He hasn't even mentioned anything about it. It's so weird. If there was something eventful in there, why would he not be talking about it? Or using that to an advantage in some way? Really, don't have too much else to say. We just had some interesting back and forth dialogue between Kaiki and Senju Gahara, and the inclusion of Hanekawa into this also makes things more interesting. I'd just like to know what info she might have that could benefit Kaiki at this point. I figure we'll see how that goes next time, guys, but for now, that's it. So thank you for watching. Make sure to leave a like and a comment if you enjoyed. Subscribe to updated on more. That would be great. Let me know what you thought of the episode. But next time is episode 5, the penultimate chapter, the semi-finale for Koi Monogatari, and there's a lot that can happen in 2 episodes, definitely. So I can't wait to see exactly what goes down next time. So that be it, folks. Till we meet again, I will see you guys
later!